money, not your money. Your money is insured by the federal government. You're not going to lose a dime. Think of your families. Don't risk your life.
You know, in my opinion, every film speaks a different language. The film speaks, it's as if one movie speaks Spanish, another movie speaks German, another one Italian, another one English. And the key is to find, before you start the movie, what kind of language this film is going to speak.
This is based on observations. This is based on people I've met, people I've known, people I've sat with and talked to. Thieves, cops, killers in certain respects. So it's based on content. It's not based, and it's not derived from other cinema. It's based on some, you know, basic research and stuff.
For the research that he wanted on the convicts, he never said, you know, hold back, don't do this, don't do that. It was always go as far as you can go. Talk to the most extreme people you can talk to, as many as you can, get as much information as you can.
They hired me as a technical consultant, they gave me some stuff, but really they gave one of my books, No Be So Fierce, to all the bad guys, the De Niro mob, you know, and had them read it, because it tells it like it is, you know.
We visited a lot of guys in prison. We went to Folsom and met guys who did this type of thing. One of them had a lot of money and got caught robbing a bank. And I said, why did you continue to do it at a certain point? I mean, risk versus reward again. And he said, it was my job. That's what I knew how to do. I rob banks.
I spent some time with a lot of women who were involved with men who were in prison, and they were fascinating, some really sad stories involved with a man who was already in prison or who went to prison while they were, and just getting that whole dynamic as understood as I could.
We sat around and listened to cops talk, and I realized quite early that women were not that important, you know. I felt pretty much second class.
I made dinner for us 4 hours ago. Every time I try to maintain a consistent mood between us, you withdraw.
I got 3 dead bodies on a sidewalk off Venice Boulevard, Justine. I'm sorry if the goddamn chicken got overcooked.
In preparation for Heat, I used to go out with Tom Elfmont, who was a commander in LAPD at the time, and we would just routinely answer radio calls. Whatever there was something going on, we'd go there, you know, whether it's a homicide, an armed robbery in progress, whatever was happening. And it took us all over the city. And that's how I really learned all about LA.
I mean, he got to the point where sometimes on a couple things, calls we went on, I mean, I always had 2 guns, so sometimes I would hand him a gun because he almost became like a partner.
It was pointed out to me, it made total sense, and that is the police is not the army. The police are used to having overwhelming force. They're not assaulted by an equally well-armed, well-trained force. And so when you assault the police are not used to that. Also, when you're in a situation that Neil McCauley finds himself in, time is against you. You have to get out, and you have to get out fast, because every 10 seconds that you're staying there, more and more assets are coming in. So they have to shoot their way out, they assault the ambush, they shoot their way out, and they get out fast. That's the objective.
Michael used to like to stage things so that his actors could see what it was really like. Michael staged some interrogation scenes that John Santucci and I did for them.
Michael goes to the extent that most directors won't go to. For example, there's a restaurant I will not name, but on a certain night of the week, the police detectives would meet in the wine room at this restaurant. On a separate night of the week, the mob families would meet in the very same wine room, and Michael would stick the bad guys in there on the night that the mob families, crime families were in there, and they would have dinner together, and we would have dinner, the cops, with the detectives in the very same wine room.
The thing that happens with certain directors that you really are, you know, at the top of their game, is you feel this confidence And you feel as though you can go in there and they'll take care of the situation. They'll take care of you and they'll take care of the authenticity. They will try to go after the best you have in you.
I wanted everybody really well trained so that they felt that they could actually do what the characters in this film do, because actors responded in a very big way. Mick Gould and Andy McNabb designed the curriculum by which Val Kilmer and Bobby De Niro and Tom Sizemore would acquire the skills that they had to acquire, and then it was a different curriculum for the cops.
The preparation for the bank heist was in two parts. Obviously, there was the getting into the bank and creating the robbery, and secondly was the gunfight outside.
We cased the entire joint. I went up and got a loan application, just the way they would figure out what's going on in this bank. It was a trip, how much knowledge we got, and they didn't know what was going on.
So they were in disguise, obviously, because they're actors. Everybody would know them otherwise. They went in, carried out their task, got in the vehicles, and we drove off. And when we got the tapes back from the bank, no one had been seen. So from the actors' point of view, they know that when they were going to do it on the film, well, they've already done it in real time, so they felt a bit more comfortable with what they were doing.
Everybody took this movie really seriously, and then when we were, you know, in the planning stages of robberies and stuff, you really got that feeling, you know, this is the way it is. You know, this is how you do it.
Some of the actors thought they knew how to handle weapons, and they were, you know, disabused of that notion. I mean, it was one whole day of safety before anyone was allowed to even fire a round.
We took each individual actor and trained him how to use the weapons. When we were on the ranges, we had actually cops teaching cops. So it kind of divorced everybody. So the bad guys were bad and the good guys were good, you know. And they had the correct training.
I've never experienced anything like this. He had us out on the range to learn how to shoot guns. I've done it before. You practice, you learn, people teach you how to do it, where it goes and stuff. Only I've never done it with real bullets.
Actually, I heard something that was very flattering, that there's a shot where I run out of bullets and I change a mag and I go back to firing. I think it's the Marines. They show the clip, telling those maggots, if you can't change your clip as fast as this actor, then get out of my army.
Everything you see on the film was done live on the ranges in Orange County, on the police ranges. It was basically 3 months of training, slowly building up, so there would be three or four of them on the range, actually firing really close up, moving around, and it hit targets as well.
I was able to build the actual street to scale. We're using flats on the sheriff's ranges and train the guys to actually do everything they do, moving from station to station.
We shot all that live on the range before we actually did it with blanks downtown. So we did it for real and then went downtown and pretended.
Pretty much everything that we do in the story, short of actual murder, we did off camera.
Val and I knew each other a little bit. But in these training exercises, I mean, we got to know each other, and it's kind of has a lot of levels when you do this. You get to know the person, you get to get a sense of who they are, so that you're communicating and creating a relationship, which you can use, a familiarity that you can use when you're doing the scenes together.
The other advantage is that there could be a look on Tom Sizemore's face in the scene in Johnny's coffee shop when Neil has just bounced Wayne Gros' head on the table. And this guy in the next booth looks over there, and Sizemore looks at him, and there's no expression on his face. It's just lethal, and it's dead cold. And that's because Tom knew that Tom could do what Tom learned how to do. And so it's an authority that manifests itself in dialogue scenes that have nothing to do with weapons.
What do you mean, forget the money?
What am I doing? I'm talking to an empty telephone.
I don't understand.
Because there was a dead man on the other end of this fucking line.
Michael took a group of us on a never-ending helicopter flight over the city. It's also a way that Michael Mann has to explain a movie to his collaborators, which is not about details. He starts with the broad concept. So the fact that we flew over the city for three endless hours, just looking for a possible location for the movie, gave me a vision of where we were going to set our story.
The thing that I remember the most vividly was that he was interested in portraying Los Angeles in a completely different way than we had ever seen it before. and that it was to be an intricate part of the story in terms of all of the bits and pieces of places and spaces that the different characters of this movie occupied and how they all fit together to be a portrait of Los Angeles that is one that we were not familiar with.
One side of the story is the city, Los Angeles, and the other side is the conflict, you know, or relationship between Macaulay and Hannah. It looks in a way like one story explains the other, and the two stories really run parallel. And maybe Michael Mann's idea to choose these two characters to explain Los Angeles, and vice versa.
We would go around the city and shoot photographs of things, not necessarily a location, but it could be a crucifix, it could be an old weird restaurant, it could be, but something that had a piece or an idea that might contribute to each of the scenes.
And most of the time there's a huge room with a number of photographs. Some of them belong to the scouting of the movie, so they are very specific shots to describe a scene. Some others are just a collection of images.
And all around us on the walls, Dante and Michael had put inspiration, visual inspirations, and they were just incredible pieces of still photography that they were using both for composition and for color. And I could see already that the palette was cool. It was very blue and very gray.
There's this moment in Macaulay's life in which you know, he walks in his house, he drops his gun on a glass table, and he's entirely alone. And then he stands by the window, and you see the ocean, the flat ocean outside, and it's night. We had to gel all the windows in a very selected color. It was not too colorful, not too, you know, we had an amount of green, an amount of blue. The combination of this worked fine with that particular moment. Inside, Lee McCauley's head is an emotional, lonely factor.
There were something like 106 locations and sets, so it was quite a lot. Even though there was a style to the movie, each of these places was extremely real and believable and contributed to each of the characters in terms of telling us who they were. You wouldn't be fascinated with the characters if it was all about making it stylish. It's all about reinforcing those characters and putting them in a world that they can exist in.
We found a place where there was an illegal cockfighting area that was then changed for the movie into a pit bull fight where you find a chop shop. And those are real environments. I mean, Michael is a director who wants to take from the reality and bring that into his film rather than do something that is imaginary. When we were shooting the sequence that involved the robbery of the armored truck and then the aftermath with the death, I mean, the people who were actually there, extras on the set, were true detectives, were true investigative forensic technicians. So you're dealing with people who really know how to do their job, and that brings a level of reality to a scene that otherwise you wouldn't get.
The experience of being on that set for any director, any actor, was electric. And so there's a very collegial atmosphere among the actors and myself. It was almost like a repertory company.
Okay, we're gonna have to take them in the car. Wait till they are all in. Get clean shots. Watch your background.
The main heist and the shootout were a big challenge. We were only allowed to shoot on Saturdays and Sundays. Every weekend we'd have to pull in there, get everything set up, and then pull out of that sequence on Sunday. So you're breaking it up over a series of weekends, which I think is always challenging because you have to come back and now recreate what you were doing a week ago.
The gunfire downtown was truly horrifying sounding, and because of the skyscrapers everywhere, it was just deafening, and it would hang in the sky for maybe like 8 or 10 seconds.
We used 800 to 1,000 rounds per take when we had the cops and our criminals going at each other. I mean, it was quite an amazing sound.
In what we do, we replace everything. In movies, every sound you hear is there for a reason.
So we were mixing in three stages simultaneously. And the pre-dubs of all the effects for that reel with all the gunshots came to the stage, and Michael said, that's not the gunshot.
And everybody was in shock. He said, how can you not, what don't you like about it? And I knew what he didn't like about it because I was on location, was that it was horrifying sounding. So the big gun shootout that you hear in the movie is all production sound.
Nothing artificial or could come close to delivering the fear of the sound that the full load made moving through those automatic weapons, and the way the sound ricocheted off the walls of the buildings of an empty downtown. You couldn't manufacture the original sound. It was quite extraordinary. After I shot the film, there was a desire to release it early. Because it was an accelerated post, the editing was really important. And I worked with one of my most important artistic and collaborators, and Dov Honig, my editor. And that's a very important relationship. This is pre-digital editing, so we had an army of people. And it was a 24/7 operation. People were coming in various different shifts, and it was wild. It was a very intense community and a shared experience with all those people who were working at the same time. You really do get the sense that we were in the trenches together.
You can't separate the images from the sounds in Michael's movies, and you can't think of the bank heist in Heat without hearing that incredible percussive piece. He has a really very, very open mind as far as music goes. He's a real sonic explorer when it comes to that.
The score was so modern, so interesting. It was such a brave, artistic score.
The thing that came from the first meeting that I thought was an important component to the whole process was, I said, Michael, I think the thing that I want to do is have a budget to create a series of experiments. Experiments that were impressions of the film, but weren't exact cues. So what I did was experiment with percussion, experiment with guitar textures, with homemade instruments, with steel cello and strange combinations of sounds and sonorities. So then when it came to the point of actually composing for the movie, I had all of these sound experiments that I was able to share with Michael, and we were able to have something tactile in which to talk about.
Doing Heat was very different because when I was in a different world, and I was in many different worlds, I wanted something that would appear to be eclectic.
Michael Mann brought up Glenn Branca, and Glenn is a composer that uses wonderful, sort of, he may have like 15, 20 guitars on stage playing detuned, sort of rhythmic strumming that after a while turns into these wonderful sort of ghost-like melodies that don't really exist, but they're there. But the idea of using multiple amounts of guitars, a guitar orchestra, was a very, very compelling idea.
There's a long tradition, and there's great precedent for Michael Mann using quite obscure avant-garde music in a lot of his movies and TV shows. I mean, the music is almost as much of a character as some of the actors.
Billy!
There are only two parts in Heat where Al Pacino and Robert De Niro meet up, and both times they use my music as the background. The first time, they use a cover of a Joy Division song, Do Dawn Fades, that I did. And then the ending, that's when God Moving Over the Face of the Waters comes in. And they worked so well. On the surface of it, they shouldn't have worked. They weren't conventional choices, musically speaking. But they ended up reinforcing the narrative in such a strong way.
The end just kills me. Like these, it's like that's the love story, right? It's like the only one that could really understand Al's character, Bob's character, and that it's finding the poetry in that and not kind of stopping at the image. It's like, well, what is actually under Chino's need to chase this guy? Well, it's like, it's his twin. That's what he could have been, you know, or whatever, however you want to say it, but it's like the longing is so deep.
The thing about Neil and Hannah, which is similar, is that both men are very individualized. Each is the author of who he is, and they're both fully conscious, and they're both fully aware. Consciousness like that and awareness like that is not easy to come by.
He likes that relationship between this good guy and this bad guy, and the common ground that often happens. I mean, what separates the good from the bad sometimes, you know, is a very, very thin line. He he likes you to think, you know, maybe the good guy is really not the good guy after all, and the bad guy is not so bad.
I think it's just great filmmaking. It's a story, it grabs your attention from the beginning, and it doesn't let you go.
Actually, one of the reviews I read said, all things old are made new again. It's cops and robbers, which I had never thought of the movie that way ever, because it's so much about relationships, and it's so specific to a time and place. It's like all good movies, it transcends being pigeonholed.
The performances in the motion picture have lasting power forever, bar none. I mean, it's an actor's film.
Strangely enough, I thought for De Niro, it was a major moment. It was a quiet look at a thief who has a certain kind of lonely disregard for who he kills, but yet somehow you're in touch with his humanity. It was amazing and complex and simple at the same time.
As brilliant as I thought Bobby was, and as brilliant an actor as he is, that over the years, you know, I've appreciated for some reason more and more, you know, what he did, the precision of his internal orientation. He is so perfectly in the moment without anything artificial. There's such a high level of integrity that you'll see reflected in it, his attitude and just the way his hand moves. You know, it's just a marvelous piece of work by him.
I think what is extraordinary about the film that it is in many ways a classic Western, because the movie opens with an armored truck that's not that different from a stagecoach. And instead of Monument Valley, you are downtown Los Angeles in the canyons of a modern metropolis. And that's what's unique about it. And I think that's what people recognize, and they may not be able to specifically point to it, but it is a resonance that you find, that it's a true American art of storytelling.
Oh, I thought it was an excellent film. I thought that Michael Mann just brought it out and served it to you as an audience and kept you interested in what's basically a very simple story, but gave it an identity and a point of view, which was Michael Mann point of view, and it never wavered.
I was very ambitious about the film and its layers, its significance, what I thought about the film thematically, how it perceived the existence of these individual people, how individualized I would try to make them. And I thought it was a really good idea to make a motion picture that had a lot of people in it and you get a sense of each person's life. Well, you know, what you walk away from is your connection to the people that you work with and the times you shared. And that was quite extraordinary.
You know, it's like you said, is what I want.